Well, it's a good day for the bulls. We're holding above the 10,820-odd mark. We've had a good series so far as well. The stage is set for a good end to the November series, and the bulls, they'll be feeling very, very good. Everything going in their favour. The global setup is positive. Brent crude price is holding below $60 per barrel, and the market's just running away, Mangalam.
Absolutely. This series, 700 runs go to the bulls after 1,500 runs have gone to the bears in the previous two series. So let's see where it goes as expiry. It is day five of the test match. But we kickstart the show with all the top stories that we're tracking this morning. The big one, of course, is crude oil prices. They hold sub $60 per barrel mark, aiding the up move in oil marketing companies like HPCL as well as BPCL.
And the rupee appreciates past the 70 mark against the dollar for the first time since late August. The rupee strength hurts IT stocks like HCL Tech, Tech Mahindra, as well as TCS.
There's no respite for Yes Bank. The stock is the biggest loser on the Nifty again after ICRA has now downgraded the bank's bonds, citing corporate governance concerns. Care 2 downgrades Yes Bank from AAA to AA+.
And the metal index bounces today after being the biggest underperformer in this series. A weak dollar index, that helps up move in base metal prices. That in turn reflects in stocks like Hindalco and Vedanta. Tata Steel as well sees a bit of a bounce. What a day it has been. The markets have already started off with a good gain. But how do you trade the Nifty from here? Would you look to buy after the markets that have opened up with such a big gap up? And if you have a long position, where should your stop loss come in at? Ashwini Gujral joins in. Hi, Ashwini. What's the trade on the Nifty? I'm not sure whether you can buy at these levels, but if someone has taken a long position and they're holding it, where should their stop loss come in at?
See, there are two types of traders. One trader bought at 10,500. He has no problem even if the Nifty falls 100 points. There's this other guy who bought yesterday afternoon. For him, he is getting enough. He should back off. See, the issue is not where the Nifty is going. The issue is how many short positions are there still in the market. So as a day trader or a short-term trader, what you want to do is you want to buy a collapse. If you are buying after a 100-point rally, you buy here and the market comes off 50 points, you get into a soup. So, don't chase the market. In fact, if at some point we come back to 10,750, 770, those would be good levels for fresh, short-term, intraday style trading. Otherwise, if you've been in for 200-300 points on the Nifty, you can continue to hold. Having said that, IRB Infra is a buy with a stop of 152, target of 164. Biocon is a buy with a stop of 600. Target of 621, and Piramal is a buy with a stop of 2100, target of 2250.
Right, Ashwini, quickly before we let you go and your disclosures, HUL as well as ICICI Bank, both of them from the frontline space, have suddenly moved higher to the high point of the day. Any trades there?
See, the issue is the same. You know, if you're a positional type of person, ICICI Bank and Hind Unilever are in good, strong uptrends. Keep a stop about 350. But if you are, that intraday type trader, then the better trades for you is, the metal stocks, which after 6-7 days of downside are coming back. Maybe stuff like Bajaj Finance, which is moving up, after having not participated, L&T Finance. So those would give you better risk reward rather than ICICI or HUL.
Okay, all right. Any disclosures, Ashwini?
Well, we have a few individual long positions, but index, we are out for the moment.
Okay, all right. Thanks so much for joining in and giving us all those trades, Ashwini. We'll talk later in the day. But let's move on then. And we have been checking with companies in the consumer durable space to check whether or not the liquidity crunch has impacted demand. And the answer has clearly been a big no. Now, does the retail and apparel space also remain unaffected? We asked Mr. Rajiv Suri, the MD and CEO of Shoppers Stop. Thanks so much, Mr. Suri, for waiting by for us. And good to speak to you. How has quarter three really panned out as of now? Is demand strong enough? If you could give us some guidelines in terms of SSG growth so far.
So in quarter three, our Pujo season was very strong. Mm-hmm. We had a 19% like-for-like growth. Diwali again was strong. We had 9% like-for-like growth. So overall, the market sentiment seems to be strong. We have capitalized on providing great customer service. And based on that, the consumer has been responding.
All right. So you said 9% like-to-like growth for Diwali as well as 19% for Pujo. The last time we spoke with you, you said you were targeting close to around 5 to 6% same-store sales growth in FY19. Would you want to up that?
So I think that we have to see how it plays out over, let's say, the end of season sale and Christmas. So we still have two very big months to go. So we would not like to change our guidance for now. Although we are also having a great November, and we are hoping to end with in excess of 20% like-for-like sales in November, okay, which is partly due to tailwinds of Diwali moving from October to November.
All right, Mr. Suri, so you're sticking to the earlier guidance of around 5 to 6% same-store sales growth. That you're confident at least?
Yes.
Okay, let's focus on the margins then. By when can we see that 8% odd margin mark? FY20, is that possible?
So we are, our guidance is that we are going to increase about 100 basis points each year, and we think that we'll get to around that much this year. So we should be getting in 2021 around 8%. However, we are also investing a lot in our omni-channel, and we have to see if that will cause a drag on our vertical ratios or not.
All right, you spoke about investing in your omni-channel business. If you could tell us a little more about, you know, how much does online contribute to your overall sales right now? Amazon bought some stake in your company. So how are your products doing there? What does it account for in your total sales?
So our relationship is pretty new. It's under 1 year with Amazon. Our growth in quarter two for our omni business was 96%. Last month, our growth was 95%. So we are moving in the right direction. We still have a long way to go. As a total, we are now just above 1.5% of our business. But if we continue to grow the way we are growing, we can see that it will improve and take a higher mix going forward. On Amazon, we now have 80% of our catalog live with them. We have a microsite, a Shopper Stop microsite on their fashion page. We are also in the offline space opening kiosks within our stores. We've opened three kiosks in our stores, which have had good traction. And by the end of the year, we will open another 7 to 10.
All right, Mr. Suri, what about your private labels? What's the current revenue contribution coming in from there? And what's been the growth out there?
So private brands, over the last four quarters, from a low of 8.7%, we are now at about 10.3-10.4%. So that is heading in the right direction. We still have a long way to go in fully potentializing private brands. And our team now is in place. We have got the leadership team.
What would
which
be
is
the
fully
target
dedicated
there, sir?
To private brands. So our target over the next 3 years would be go up to 17%.
Up to 17%. And what is the margin differential between private label as well as the other brands that you sell?
So typically, private brands exit around 45 to 48%, and national brands would exit around 30 to 35%.
All right, so that's a 15% differential. And the other thing, is there a margin differential between men's apparel and women's apparel? What are you doing to get the ladies to shop more at your stores?
They are shopping more, actually, Mr. Suri. You know, I wanted to ask you that as well. What exactly is the contribution from, you know, between ladies and men? When I go out with my wife, it's almost 100 to 0. But in terms of our actual mix, what is it as of now?
So we are doing a lot for our women customer, and we really believe that she is the main driver to getting the family in and doing the shopping. And currently, we have about 35% of our business as men's, and mostly the rest is women.
All right, Mr. Suri, finally, before we let you go, you know, the apparel space is heating up quite a bit. There is strong competition coming in from not just Reliance Retail or international players, Future Retail, Future Lifestyle, rather. How are you protecting Shopper Stop's positioning, and how is Shopper Stop still as relevant as it was, say, 10, 15 years ago?
So we are going to continue to keep our focus on being true to our customer and to provide our customer a delightful shopping experience. We are the leading department store chain in India. We are expanding to metro cities as well as tier one cities. But I believe that the competition can expand in whichever way they like, but our focus is going to be on our customer. We have a very clear strategy on how we want to engage with the customers through our First Citizen program, through our beauty selection and providing the largest assortment, our personal shopper program, which we are now at 13% of sales, which is 47% better than last year. And so we're going to continue on our journey to focus on the customer and retain our spot as being their favorite place to shop.
All right, Mr. Suri, wish you good luck for that. Let's see whether he does go ahead and, you know, maintain the sort of positioning that Shopper Stop has had in the wake of this competition. At the same time, maintaining 5 to 6% same store sales growth for this year. A century on the Nifty, there you have it, 100 points, and there time for the Bulls to raise their bat. What 10,828 for the Nifty. The Sensex almost closing in on that four century mark, 375 points on the Sensex. Nifty Bank, Nigel, almost a 200 point.
Almost
uptake.
200 runs out there. I mean, splendid going over here. They're seeing the ball nice and big. It's coming onto the bat nicely, and they're hitting it out of the park.
Absolutely. Let's see who all are hitting it out of the park, actually. You have the FMCG stocks, of course, HUL, Titan, Asian Paints has joined that list. Infosys is doing fairly well as well. And this, remember, despite the rupee strengthening, so the IT stocks, they've been doing fairly well over the last three trading sessions, continuing their uptick for Infosys itself. Over the last three trading sessions, Infosys has gained about 8.5-9% at the high point of the day now. And we have Lupin and Bajaj Finance doing too well too. So, yeah, all the batsmen firing as we speak. The Nifty raising its bat with a 100-point move. With that, we shift focus to the big national story now. The Supreme Court will hear the petition filed by Alok Verma against the CVC order of removing him from active duty as CBI director. Ashmit Kumar now joins us on the phone line with all the details. Ashmit, take it away.
Well, clearly a big day, another showdown at the hands of the apex court. The two set of counsels, Alok, one for Alok Verma, the other one for Rakesh Asthana, will face off again. Of course, this comes on the back of the CVC report which had been submitted. CVC had been probing charges that were leveled against Alok Verma. That report had been filed. And subsequently, Justice Gogoi had observed that some of the findings of the report are favorable, while some others are uncomplimentary in nature. But nonetheless, Alok Verma had been asked to file a reply. He did file a reply, again, within a sealed cover. However, within that time period, M.K. Sinha, another CBI officer, had filed an application which had made various charges unsubstantiated, but charges nonetheless against none other than the NSA chief, Ajit Doval, himself, that he has been interfering in the investigations against Rakesh Asthana, that he has been pressurizing Alok Verma. And while those charges were being made, CJI Justice Gogoi, he lashed out at the Alok Verma camp for what he was referring to. Again, a thinly veiled reference, but nonetheless, Justice Gogoi lashed out saying that this is not a platform, that the court is not a platform for airing of such insinuations. He lashed out at the Alok Verma camp for leakages as far as the Alok Verma response is concerned. And on the back of that, the hearing had been deferred to today. Now, what can we expect from today? Essentially, the big question that's on everyone's mind is that will the Apex Court go ahead and reinstate Alok Verma? If it chooses to not do so, then the obvious question that arises is, will there be a further investigation of the charges against him? And what does this do as far as the Rafale deal is concerned? Keep in mind that the Supreme Court has also reserved its judgment in the Rafale matter. The prayer in the Rafale case is quite clear that a CBI investigation is sought, but with the current state of affairs, there can be no investigation. So clearly, all eyes now on today's hearing and the road forward that the Apex Court will map out as far as this CBI versus CBI saga is concerned. Back to you.
Okay, thanks so much, Ashmit, for joining in and giving us all those details. Well, let's shift focus now and let's talk about the GST collections. Remember, if in fact the crude oil prices were going up, that's going to hurt our deficit numbers. But what could help is the GST collections really pick up. So those are the two factors that the street is looking at. Crude oil prices, as well as how are the GST collections shaping up? And that's our next CNBC TV 18 exclusive then. Sources tell us that the GST collections for October, that's recorded in November, is likely to come in at around 97,000 crore rupees. Timsi Jaipuria joins us with all those exclusive details. Timsi, over to you.
Well, as you rightly mentioned, GST collections are likely to come a little lower than the last month, where we saw that for the first time in the current fiscal, GST collections had crossed 1 lakh crore mark. But this time, for the collections of October, which were recorded in November, the trend is of slightly lower collections, coming down to 97,000 odd crore rupees. And yes, government feels that this is because of the festival sales have cooled off. Secondly, the rupee appreciation is also one of the reasons, because you get customs, imports, etc. collections also recorded in this. And now that rupee has cooled off a little bit, stabilization has also led to a little lower collections. But nonetheless, government is quite hopeful that in the months to come, from January onwards, the collections are likely to pick up yet again going forward from over 1 lakh crore rupee mark. So let's see what are the final numbers when government releases them on 1st of December. But yes, right now sources indicate that around 67 lakh businesses have registered and paid so far, and the collections are likely to be a little lower at 97,000 odd crore rupees.
Right, Timsi, thanks a lot for that. Those are the numbers that the street will be watching for very, very closely as far as GST collections are concerned. But right now I'm watching or taking a look at the markets. A double century for the Nifty Bank has been achieved. Two bats raised out there. And the Sensex too hit the quadruple century 400 point mark. And now maybe we're counting down to a century for the mid-cap index, which is otherwise underperforming with a gain of just about 66 points. So counting down to that one. But talking about counting down, as the countdown for 2019 general election begins, the Modi government is likely to go as per tradition and present a vote on account in 2019 instead of a full budget. Sapna Das joins in with more details. Sapna, what are you picking up?
Well, we are clearly given to understand that most likely it's going to be a vote on account. That's what the government seems to be preparing for as per convention. And the convention always has been that it's an interim budget or a vote on account in an election year. Having said that, what this would really mean is that the government will seek the parliament's nod for 4 months of expenditure, April, May, June, July, for the new financial year. Although the revenue and the expenditure estimates are always done for the full fiscal. So that does not change. But what changes is the appropriation bill will be for 4 months, which will allow the government to seek the parliament's nod to, you know, draw the funds from the Consolidated Fund of India and do the expenditure of 4 months till a full government or a new government comes into place. Having said that, the other thing we need to keep in mind is that in terms of new announcements or any future roadmap for reform, that's completely a political call. But nothing prevents the government from, you know, announcing schemes, and it's not necessary that you have to come out with an immediate expenditure outlay for that. For example, the Ayushman Bharat can be can be kept in mind. The announcement came in this financial year in the finance minister's budget speech, but it took some time for the government to kind of, you know, explain the expenditure outlay, and even that has not been fully outlined so far in the current year's budget. So something may come forward on that front. So that's an example that I'm just giving. So nothing prevents the government from making these announcements, but that's again a political call. Last but not the least, no direct tax changes. What the finance bill will basically seek is a continuation of the existing direct tax laws, so no changes there. Continuation till the full budget is presented sometime in July. And last but not the least, also in terms of your indirect tax changes, well, they can be done at any point in time, but it's only the customs part which remains purely with the central government. The rest of the things have been given over to the GST Council.
Thanks so much for that, Sapna. Well, Mangalam is in cricketing mood this morning. He's talking about everyone raising their bats, celebrating centuries, double centuries. But Yes Bank, that seems to have, you know, got the googly, and it's clean bowled actually, because it's down close to 8%.
It's a no ball.
When you have the entire market that's at the high point of the day, and that stock continues to reel under pressure. Mangalam, if I get that numbers right, I think the book value for the next couple of years is estimated at around 150, 160 rupees. So it's trading at less than one time price to book. But as we always discuss, the risk is in the book itself. itself, yep, and various other risks as well. And the stock is just selling off. Remember, the markets are up 100 points and Yes Bank has moved to the low point of the day. So these are clearly some concerning signs as well, because the stock is just moving lower. On the flip side, Piramal Enterprises, that was a stock that was under pressure a couple of days ago because of the exposure to the Lodha Group. We had the Lodha Group that joined us yesterday. They said that, you know, all is well. We have not defaulted on any payment and everything. You know, the bond yield that had moved up is on a very thinly traded bond. That stock, Piramal Enterprises, after the clarification from Lodha Group to CNBC TV 18, the stock has recovered close to 6-7% from yesterday's lows. So just keep an eye out.
Nifty, which is above the 10,800 mark, will be very interesting to see how the options data stacks up ahead of expiry. So the 10,800 put, that one's added 34 lakh shares in open interest just the first few hours of trade, 1.5 hour of trade. And the bulls believe 10,800 is the mark they can protect for a premium of 16 points. So with that, we wrap up on Chartbusters. But as we do that, we leave you with some market opinion coming in from Ashwini Agarwal of Ashmore Investment Management.
A weakness in the US dollar historically has meant strength in emerging markets. We also felt that the sell-off in the emerging markets that had happened year-to-date at that point in time was a little too excessive. We weren't seeing any significant imbalances in the emerging market story in terms of current account balances or fiscal balances. So we felt that as things started to normalize and the dollar starts to come off, we should see significant strength in emerging markets, and that's what has come through. So in a sense that, you know, we're quite happy to see what's happened. It's in line with our expectations. I think the consensus till now was obviously a December hike and then four more hikes next year. So I suppose that four more hike commentary might come off a little bit. We are reasonably positive about earnings. We think that a softer oil, if it sustains, actually bodes very well for India and should bode well for liquidity as well. My sense is that if you were to look at the Nifty universe, it would be somewhere in the high teens or mid-teens, say somewhere in the region of 15 to 17%. That's where I would put the number at this point in time.